Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Unpopular Kids. It is I, your host, Nelson Moises Lassiter, or as the Americans say, Nelson Moses Lassiter. Today, we are going to talk about something really interesting. And it was something I've been trying to figure out how to articulate for a while. You know, as many of you may know, there have been these series of protests that was happening all across the country. And a lot of people are now opening their eyes to what's really going on. It's as if the veil has been pulled back and the reality is sinking in. And a lot of people, you know, are having this feeling of fear and uncertainty and guilt and pain and hurt and suffering. And a lot of white people are feeling this for the first time. And what's really fascinating about this is that you know, they're always asking, you know, how are you doing? Are you all right? Are you okay? And what's really interesting about this is that this is something that Black people have been experiencing and feeling for a very long time. So this isn't new to us. This is new for you. And to know that you feel this hurt and this pain and this guilt and this shame and oppression, and you see that police are now, you know, using the same tactics towards white people that are protesting, and you're like, this is unfair, this is unjust, the police are wrong. You know, white people have only experienced this for a short period of time, but Black people have experienced this all our lives. So imagine how we feel. You don't need to ask how we feel because you're feeling it, you're seeing it. And we've been fighting this fight for a very long time. So, you know, don't worry about how we're feeling and worry about how it makes you feel and how you're compelled to want to do something about it and continue to do something about it. That's the best approach. You know, I want to start by, you know, rewinding a little bit back. I don't know if you remember what your school days were like. For me, I went to a private school. I was very, very blessed and lucky to go there. Like I mentioned before, I was one of few, one of two, maybe at one point, maybe three, then went back down to two Black students in the class. And what was really interesting about that is I remember, you know, the level of attention that was put on to studying and researching. And I remember, you know, one of the things that was really hard to research and study was Shakespeare. Because it felt like a foreign language. It was English, but it was a form of English that we weren't used to, a form of English that we didn't understand, a form of English that was hard for us to interpret. You know, it's like very, very poetic, but at the same time, it's the meaning is hidden. You know, and you really have to dive into it to understand the meaning and the core of what is trying to be said. You know, and you get some really beautiful poetic moments like Lady Macbeth saying, "Unsex me here." You know, and when you dive into that statement, you realize she's saying she knows the gender roles that have been given to her in society. But she decided she's not going to be limited by those gender roles anymore. And if being treated like a man is what she needs to do, or lose what makes her a woman is what she needs to do to achieve what she wants to achieve, then that is what she is willing to do. And she says, "Unsex me here." So that's what's really crazy about it. So much context and content and significance can be put into one tiny piece. That's what makes, you know, Shakespeare so fascinating. And that's what makes, you know, diving into a language that you don't understand so fascinating, even though it's English. You know, you'll pick up bits and pieces of it, but you won't truly understand it. Another example is Geoffrey Chaucer, The Canterbury Tales. When I was in high school, we actually had to memorize The Canterbury Tales. And it's very, very poetic. It was beautiful. You know, it's, I think it was something like, "Wan the apriyo with the shower suit, the drought of March had parsed it to the root. And bothered every vine and switch liquor, which thereto engendered is the flora. When the feet sake with the swades of breath, and spread it half in every holt and heather tender croppus, and the youngest son of in the ram is half of course your own. And smaller phallus, marking melodia, that sleeping earlier than each with open ear, so pricketh him not shorter than courageous. Then longing folk to go on pilgrimages and pamadas for the sake and strongest for an ahondas, cool than sundry londas. Especially, for maybe she is endingly on to Canterbury, they wonder. The holy blissful martyr for to seek her, them that have hoped when they were sick. Now, what's really fascinating about that is, again, it's English, but it's a different form of English you can't necessarily understand. But you can pick out bits and pieces to get an understanding of where it's going, but then you have to dive in deeper to get the research. You gotta dive in deeper to research and understand what he's really talking about. And you're like, oh wow, this is really beautiful. It's about people going to see this, you know, to the Church of Canterbury, to see this saint, you know, and it's really beautiful, and it's very poetic, and so much imagery of the wind blowing and the weather changing, and it's really great. You know, it just because the initial language of it sounds pretty and you can pick up the bits and pieces of English, but once you dive into it, it brings whole new meaning and you understand it even more, you know, and that's what makes it really, really cool. Now, when we were in school, there were two different approaches to this. One would be we would, you know, go in and do all the research and really figure it out so that we can get to the core of what it means and really understand it and be able to internalize it and take it and figure out how to move forward with it and how to write the best paper we could so that we can get that A and pass with great grades. The other approach was Sparknotes or Cliff Notes. You know, it's like, well, doing all the research is going to take too much time. So let me, you know, go to Sparknotes, since someone had already did the research and broke it down, and then I'll just look at what they did and I'll just like add that to my paper and create my research that way. The crazy thing about Sparknotes is that, you know, you're only getting one perspective. You're getting what someone else interpreted it to be. You're getting what that person wanted it to be, and in doing so, you know, you're only learning that perspective. And that perspective might not be the right one, or it could be, you know, but it got to the point though, where a lot of people started doing that teachers were like, it's interesting that all the students have the same thesis on this topic, but that thesis doesn't explain their own perspective, doesn't explain how they're moved by the story, doesn't explain what compels them to want to actually, you know, write the best paper they can, doesn't provide a new POV. And when the teachers realize that, they start failing people because they're like, you're not doing the research. You're not understanding the beauty of Geoffrey Chaucer. You're not understanding the intricacies of Shakespeare. Because if you did, you would understand how these things, you know, how these things can draw parallels to your life, and how these parallels can change the way that you see the world, and how these parallels can, you know, allow you to be a more artistic, creative, or social person. Literature has the ability to do that. Literature is a lens. It's a mirror in which we can see ourselves. And unless we put the research in, we'll never truly get what we need to get out of it. Because if we're just getting the Sparknotes version, we're never going to be able to truly understand what it means, and we'll never be able to truly feel, and we'll never be able to truly understand the impact or realize how we can be inspired to have that impact or that same impact. That is the danger of Sparknotes and Cliff Notes. Now, I'll admit, I'm guilty. I've definitely done that, you know, maybe once or twice, or if my teachers are watching, once in my life, for papers. The thing is, they catch on and they know. So it got to a point where I had to put in the research myself. And when I did, it was amazing because it enlightened me. It changed the way that I saw the world. It gave me a greater appreciation for Macbeth. It gave me a greater appreciation for, you know, as one of my teachers would call Hamlet, poetry unlimited. It gave me a greater appreciation for Geoffrey Chaucer. It gave me a greater appreciation for Beowulf and Njal Saga. And then I was like, I need to know more. Then I started researching the findings that happened at Sutton Hoo when they dug up the ships and they dug up the helmets. And you realize that this literature is also history, and that this history influences our history, influences our lives. And then I just wanted to know more, had to know more. So I did, I researched more. And it's so fascinating because it was the more that I decided to research it and discover it for myself, the more that everything began to change and nothing was the same ever again. And the more I then knew how to dissect and understand Shakespeare, the more I knew what it meant, the more I could see the parallels that was happening in my everyday life, and the more I was able to apply those things, the more I was able to discern those things, the more I was able to apply that to me to be a better human being. Literature has that ability. Literature has that power. But you have to do the research. And that's what brings me to my point today. So many people now have the veil pulled back. They now know what is happening in society. They now see the oppression. They now see the systemic racism. They now see that the noise that Black people were making for years is not just noise. It's a real situation. Now that they're protesting on the front lines, they're seeing the way the police treat Black people versus the way police treat them. A friend of mine said, in her own words, "I used my white body as a shield because I saw that they were treating me as a white woman differently than the Black women that were standing side by side." And that is the reality. And that is what we're experiencing. And I appreciate the activism. I appreciate the allies. I went to a rally and they said, you know, this one woman apologized for being so blind, apologized for being complacent, apologized for saying, you know, "I don't see color." Because now she realizes she has to see color. And that colors are beautiful. And that the world is full of color. But not everyone treats those colors the same. And then another person got up, and it was a Black woman, and she said, "I have a migraine today." And that poem that she told, her name was The Oracle, she's out here in LA, that poem that she told talked about the pain that a mother is feeling, that her son was taken away from her unlawfully by the police. And she had this migraine that wouldn't go away because as a mother, she had to bury her child, which is against the laws of nature. A mother should never have to bury their own child. It's a pain that is indescribable, a pain that is deep in the core, a pain that makes it hard for you to get up, but you have to find a way to get up because you have no other choice. That is a reality that Black people are experiencing. There was another woman that stood up, and I am very thankful for women standing up and being at the front lines, because there's no one more oppressed in this world than women. There's no one more oppressed in this world than a Black woman. And to see these women come together in unity is just one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. One of them looked at the crowd and saw how diverse it was. She saw there were Latinos, she saw there were Asians, she saw there were Middle Eastern people, she saw that there were Black people, she saw that there were white people, and that everyone was willing to put their bodies on the line, their lives on the line for this cause. And it's interesting because Black people have this shared struggle. We are all a part of the diaspora that has put us in this world. We are all a part of the diaspora that has left us in America. And it's so fascinating because we have this term that we use for men and women that are part of the struggle. We call them brothers and sisters. My brother, my sister. And this woman, this Black woman said, "For all of you that are truly our allies, that are willing to give up your privilege so that we all can have privilege, willing to put your body and life on the line so that we can have our bodies and our lives, you are a part of this struggle. You too are my brothers and my sisters." I thought that was one of the most beautiful things I heard. And what was really fascinating about it was that there were so many people after that, you know, white people, they were asking, what is it that I can do? I now see the veil has been pulled back. What can I do? What you can do is realize that now that the veil is pulled back and the reality is there, it's now time for you to do the research. Asking Black people for guidance on what you as a privileged white person in power can do is like using Sparknotes. It's Sparknotes activism. It's Sparknotes racism. You'll never truly understand what it is if you're only going by one account. If you're only going by one person's words. Because you're not actually doing the paper. You're not writing the paper. You're not putting in the effort. You're not fighting the fight. If you're using Sparknotes. Asking a Black person or those that are suffering what to do is like using Sparknotes. Think of it this way. Here's another analogy. Imagine, let's use an extreme example. Let's say that you're a white person and you have a plantation and you're an overseer and you see slaves working, and then you whip those slaves and they're in pain and they're crying, and you whip those slaves, they're in pain and they're crying, and then you take their cotton that they've labored and pricked in bloodied hands, that they've pricked and sweated in that field for. You take that cotton, you sell that cotton, you make lots of money, you build your plantation, you eat beautiful food while they're eating the leftovers. And then a bunch of people start saying slavery is bad. And you're like, you're right, slavery is bad. I agree. And then you go to that Black person that you just whipped. You go to that Black person you just took the cotton from. You go to that Black person that you did not pay them for their labor, and you say, slavery is bad. What can I do to help and change this? As a slave owner, you're already benefiting from the system. You're a part of the system. You're whipping. You're taking things away. You already know what you can do. One Black person may say, well, you can stop making me, you know, pick the cotton. It's hurting my hands. Someone else could say, you can actually start feeding us real food. Someone else could say, you can pay me for that labor. Someone else could say, you can stop whipping me. But these are all the things that you have already been doing. You need to open your eyes and realize what you are doing. Because if you listen to one Black person and get his Sparknotes account, you will stop making them pick the cotton. But that doesn't solve the fact that you're still making money off of that cotton. It doesn't solve the fact that you're still giving them shitty food. It doesn't solve the fact that you're still whipping them in the fields. It doesn't solve the fact that you're not paying them. Another one can say, okay, you can stop whipping me. Okay, you'll stop whipping them. And you'll stop having them pick cotton. It doesn't solve the fact that you're still profiting from that cotton. It doesn't solve the fact that you're still not feeding them food. It doesn't solve the fact that they are still slaves. You know what you can do because the answer is right in front of you. You are benefiting from the system off of them. So it's important that you then now do that research and look into what's happening. What, they say slavery is bad. What is it about slavery? Because this is my entire life. It's all built around this. I don't know anything else. What is going to happen to my livelihood if I stop doing this? So let's figure it out, you know? Let's figure it out. So let's see. I've already stopped them from being whipped. I've already stopped them from getting bloodied fingers. I've already stopped them from working long hours. I've already stopped profiting off of their cotton. I've already stopped not, you know, giving them free labor. Now I'm paying them. Okay. You've done these steps. Slavery still exists. Plantation owners elsewhere are still benefiting from it. Then you're like, well, I can't make them change what they're doing. The problem is, you're not doing the research to understand how you can change things, because as a person that's in privilege and power, you already know you have the world at your fingertips. You have the power to do it. Asking the powerless what to do is like asking a slave how to end slavery. They're not the ones that created slavery. They're not the ones that are benefiting from slavery. You are. You're the one that's benefiting from the system. You're the one that knows exactly what you're doing to them. It's just that you've been so ingrained in society with it that you don't even realize what you're doing is wrong. Or maybe you do. But that is the point. If you feel that you want to change, and you feel you need to do something, you want to know what to do, do the research. Understand how you're benefiting from this system. Understand why your life is completely different. Go deeper to realize the oppression and the microaggressions and the things that you do in your everyday life that is so normalized to you that you don't even notice it. That is how you're going to beat it. You need to do the research. You can't just take what someone else has said, that's what someone else says. You can't just, you know, repost something. You can't do hashtag activism. You actually have to be active in your everyday life. You have to actually do the work, do the research. You want to be successful, you have to do the work. You want to build an app, you have to do the work. You want to write a book, you have to do the research and do the work. This is no different. If it's something you truly care about, you have to do the work. You have to do the research. For the Christians out there, the Bible says you have to show yourself approved. Read the word of God for yourself, so that you will understand the words. Therefore, when he comes to you or someone says that they come as him, you can know the truth. Because if you know the word, you will know the fruits of the Spirit, and you will know if it's truly someone that God has sent. So the same applies here. You have to do the research. You have to show yourself approved. It's something you genuinely feel you need to change, because you feel that guilt and that veil is unveiled, you know, revealed and pulled back, and the reality that truly exists is there. Then you have to do the research to make that change. You cannot ask other people to do the work for you. Because just like writing that paper, you're going to fail. The teacher will fail you. No more Sparknotes activism. No more Sparknotes racism. You need to understand it for yourself. Because only when you truly understand it, you will realize its impact on society. You will realize its impact on you. You will realize its impact on those around you. You will realize its impact on your friends and your family, whether they're black or white. You'll realize how those are benefiting from it. You'll realize how those are not benefiting from it. Don't listen to what these other people say. Don't look at these data notes that other people are giving you. Do the research yourself. Gotta do the research. That's the only way you'll truly understand. 50 years ago, when people were protesting, it was Sparknotes racism, Sparknotes activism, asking the black people what to do, what to do, what to do. We are doing everything that we can. We have been fighting this fight alone for so many years. Black people have been doing what they can do as those that are not in the position of power. But those that are in the position of power have the ability to change things. They have the ability to change the system. but they have to do the research to know how, if they truly care. If you truly care about your Black friend, if you truly care about your Black girlfriend or your Black boyfriend or your Black husband or your Black wife or your Black family or your Black friends or your Black coworkers, you need to do the research yourself. Because if you don't want them to suffer and you want them to benefit from this system the same way that you benefited from this system, you want everyone to benefit from this system and have the same rights, equal rights, civil rights, you need to do the research. And then you will be pointed to your lighthouse. Then you will be pointed to your North Star that will show you what it is you need to do. Because the more that you do the research, you will realize that, oh, as a slave owner, I was buying the slaves. I need to make sure that you can't buy slaves anymore. I need to make sure that Black people have rights. I need to make sure that they have identification. I need to make sure that they eat. I need to make sure they get paid. I need to make sure that they have the opportunity to build a life for themselves the same way that I am building a life for me. But I realize that the way that I'm building my life off of their labor is not a system that is fair. Therefore, I cannot continue the life that I'm living in this system. The system needs to change. Because he did the research. Because he did the research. That is how you make change. You do the work. You do the research. So I'm putting everyone on notice. Do not be a Sparknotes activist. Do not be a Sparknotes anti-racist. You need to do the work if you truly care. And if you don't care enough to do the work, then take a seat. Don't blast on Instagram. Don't blast on social media. If you're not willing to do the research, take a seat. Because there are people that are working hard, and there are people that are suffering, and there are people that genuinely want change that are willing to do the research. And for those of you that really want to help and you don't know how, just do the research. Just do it. It will change your world. Look up YouTube videos. There's tons of them. Look up research. There's papers. If you don't feel like you have enough time to read, like, I'm not going to put you on notice or anything like that, but I understand. There's a lot of information out there. There's a lot of stuff happening. But at the same time, we also have to continue to live lives. Black people have continued to live their lives through all this oppression, but we still continue to fight. We found a way to do both. If we can find a way to do both, and we're the ones that are being marginalized and oppressed, you, in a position of power and privilege, can definitely find a way to do both. Just do the research. Learn for yourself. Discover for yourself. Show yourself approved. Show yourself worthy of the title, my white brother and my white sister. Show yourself worthy to call yourself an anti-racist. Show yourself worthy to call yourself an American. Or for those internationals, show yourself worthy to call yourself a citizen of the world and a human being. No more Sparknotes activism. No more Sparknotes racism. It's time for you to do the work. And I know with all of this reality that you're now experiencing, that so much is coming at you at once and you don't know where to start. The easiest starting point is history. Find out why people were protesting back then. Find out why they're protesting now. Find out why it's easy for cops to join the force. Find out why Black people are being targeted. Find out why Black people couldn't move into white neighborhoods. Find out why the system is perpetuated to put Black people in prisons for the same crimes white people do, or for being, you know, unlawfully arrested or targeted. Find out why. Put the research in. And the more you begin to understand, you will find your calling and what you need to do. Don't let my words be the starting point for you. Let your interest and your curiosity and your desire to understand be the starting point for you. For example, let's say you work in entertainment. Find out why Black people feel like they're not represented in Hollywood. Find out why that more Black people aren't given prominent roles. Find out why that people feel that Black people don't sell tickets in theaters. Find out why. And it's going to take you down this entire train that's going to open your mind. And eventually you're going to realize everything is connected. And that is where you will find your purpose. That is where you will find what it is you need to do as a privileged person in position of power. When you realize the system that you've benefited from and you realize the system of privilege you've been given, then you'll understand what it is you need to do within that system or change that system. I'll end it by saying, whether you see it or not, or realize it or not, don't whip the slave and ask the slave what you've done wrong. Just don't whip the slave. No more Sparknotes activism. No more Sparknotes racism. Do the work, do the research, and you will know what to do next. And you will truly earn that title of my brother, my sister, my fellow American. Thank you.